Hello, everybody. I'm Kevin Wynn, and this is Rewind, the show that looks back on Florida's past through historic film and video. This time, local TV made from scratch. We'll watch two of the oldest and rarest TV shows in the Wolfson Archives collections.
News Center of the South, here is today's Florida News picture.
Rival Battery, exclusive maker and seller of the best battery you can buy, presents Ralph Renick reporting the news.
First up, unrest in Cuba reaches the streets of Miami and Ralph Renick's newscast. The story of the Cuban consul in Miami and his stolen briefcase was breaking news on March 10, 1958. Watch Miami newsman Renick reveal its contents also in the news, a jailbreak in downtown Miami, and live in-studio commercials featuring longtime WTVJ weatherman Bob Weaver. And now, here's Ralph Renick.
News Center of the South, here is today's Florida news picture.
Rival Battery, exclusive maker and seller of the best battery you can buy, presents Ralph Renick reporting the news.
Last Wednesday, the Cuban consul general in Miami was attacked in the waiting room of Miami's International Airport. A briefcase was seized at that time from Eduardo Hernandez. One man in the group ran to 36th Street holding the briefcase, jumped into a waiting car, and made good his getaway. Three other men, Cuban exiles, were seized by police. Consul Hernandez has sworn out a complaint with the state attorney charging robbery and assault. Enemies of Cuban President Batista claimed the briefcase was stolen because it contained secret reports on the activities of Cuban rebels here. Police have been unable to locate the briefcase or its contents. This afternoon, a courier delivered to me the missing briefcase. It was wrapped in a department store shopping bag. The initials EDH are on the light tan leather case. Now here are the contents of a letter which accompanied this briefcase.
Mr. Ralph Renick, WTVJ, Channel 4, Miami, Florida. Dear Mr. Renick, the sender of this briefcase is the only guilty party in this matter. I ask forgiveness of the people and authorities of Miami for my act, which was only done to save the lives of three Cuban patriots who live in Cuba and whose photographs, general description, and place where they are living and hiding in Cuba were being taken in that briefcase by the Consul Hernandez to be delivered in Havana to the assassins of the dictatorship. If I had not done what I did, today there would be three more dead patriots added to the long list of those already slain. As I did not take that briefcase for any other purpose, I am returning same to you, so you can return it to the Consul Hernandez together with the $185 that he claimed it contained. It also contains intelligence information as to the movements of rebels in Miami, reports by unregistered foreign agents about Cubans in the United States, photographs of Cubans whose lives are in grave danger if they return to Cuba, but who are now saved harmless by being here under asylum. Please note that the photographs and some documents have been obtained by the Consul Hernandez from the supposed secret files of the Key West and Dade County Police Departments. I don't know the law, but how did he get them? I think this is of interest to Mr. Gerstein and the FBI. All the people of the USA are entitled to know by these proofs that Cuban Consul Hernandez is Batista Gestapo chief in Miami, a foreign agent who flaunts the law by not being registered as such with the Justice Department, and whose duty is to gather information, spy, prosecute, and inform the authorities of Cuba about those patriots in the USA that are to be liquidated upon their return to Cuba. Truly yours, O. Arce, a Cuban who loves liberty.
Well, that was the accompanying letter with the briefcase, and in the briefcase was the $185 mentioned in the letter, stuck in the side, along with some documents and photographs, a white shirt. Now, six of the photographs are official Dade County Sheriff's Office mug shots, not identified by name. 21 of the other photographs are mug shots taken by the Key West Police Department. These men allegedly were captured at Big Pine Key a few months ago, caught on a boat with arms and ammunition to be used in a landing on the Cuban coast. Also in the briefcase, three color photographs of a boat along with an airplane. Two close-ups show the plane's tail section with a serial number of the aircraft and the American flag painted on the airplane. Six other photographs show four different individuals. There's a fingerprint chart of a Jose Aquieres Filat, and six other mugshots were taken by Cuban police and investigative departments. The correspondence and documents refer to a boat from Clearwater used by 30 rebels and to other matters involving Cuban rebels in Florida. It is not known, of course, what material, if any, may have been retained by the person or the persons who did steal this briefcase. I asked Dade State Attorney Richard Gerstein to be at WTVJ's studio at 6:30 tonight, as I had some important material to turn over to him. Mr. Gerstein, I would like at this time to transfer the stolen property to you, and at the same time to ask what action, if any, will be taken against the persons or person involved in this theft.
First, I'd like to express my sincere appreciation to you, Ralph, for your cooperation with my office. As you know, there is a case pending in the criminal court of record in which three men are charged with robbery and grand larceny as a result of the assault and the subsequent theft of this briefcase. Now, it would certainly be my suggestion to the person who delivered the briefcase to you and who wrote you the letter which you've just read that he surrender himself to the state attorney so that we can properly prosecute the case against the person responsible for the theft, so that no persons will be charged with a crime who should not be charged with it, and so that we can resolve this incident. I might further mention to you that we, of course, have no political interest in Cuba. We're not interested in resolving any difficulties that the present government might have or that the persons who are antagonistic to the present government might have. My only interest is in seeing that there is no violence perpetrated in Dade County.
Well, the writer of the letter said it might be of interest for you to know that some official Dade and Monroe County Sheriff's Department mugshots were in the briefcase. Is there anything illegal that you know about possession of such pictures?
Well, I certainly will be interested in determining how those pictures came into the possession of the consul. If he had them legally or otherwise, he might well have had them in a legal fashion. He might not have. That will certainly be looked into. I certainly want to confer with the FBI in regard to this question, too.
Thank you, State Attorney Gerstein.
Thank you, Ralph.
I'll have further comment on this in tonight's editorial. And now this report from High Volt Battery.
Here's one of the most important rules for pleasant driving. The sure, quick, extra power you get from my high-volt battery. Bob, let's spell it out, okay?
Okay.
H
is for higher power.
I
is for immediate starts every time in any kind of weather.
V
is for very high voltage.
O
is for overall better car performance.
L
stands for longer life.
And T
stands for toughness and durability.
And along with this top quality battery, you get top quality service, road service from my high volt radio dispatch trucks, and checkups from my high volt's new modern service department.
And trained mechanics can check your car regularly with the free battery, regulator, and generator checkup. Now remember, the high volt plant is conveniently located at 1850 Northwest 7th Avenue.
And I'm open weekdays from 7:30 to 7, and Saturdays from 7:30 to 5:30.
So be smart.
Get the right start. See,
High Volt.
Police tonight are pushing a three-state search for two desperate criminals who escaped from Dade County's jail last night. 32-year-old Norman Mackowitz, accused of killing a Bell Harbor policeman, and 40-year-old Howard Pickott, admitted rapist of a homestead girl. Two others in the jailbreak, 18-year-old Roger Wayne Carter and 27-year-old Ed Kelly, were captured at the scene. Carter is awaiting trial for the slaying of a handyman during a holdup attempt, and Kelly is a federal prisoner charged with auto theft. Police late today sped to a point some 5 miles north of Hialeah Gardens on Okeechobee Road in the belief they had trapped one of the escapees. Hialeah Gardens Police Sergeant Jerry Frost spotted a suspicious person along the road and fired his pistol when the man ran into the weeds. Frost called for help. Detectives from Dade Sheriff's Criminal Bureau and State Police arrive and begin a search of the area. A bloodhound was brought to the scene, and officers began crisscrossing a large open field and searching along a drainage canal. After 2 hours, Hialeah Gardens Police Lieutenant Ed Dubois spotted the man, pulled him from the brush-covered canal. These exclusive films by WTVJ newsman Bob Brumfield and George Contouris show the capture. The man is Frank Fogle. He escaped from the city stockade this morning, was not one of the two escapees wanted from last night's jailbreak.
This was the scene last night, moments after the court had escaped from the 23rd floor. Two of the men were recaptured at the scene. A police cordon was thrown around the building as search parties scoured the skyscraper in a vain attempt to capture Makowitz and Picot. Roll towels used for the final two floors to freedom, a time-tested method used by other escapees. A statewide alert now expanded to a three-state alarm brought every available law enforcement officer into action. Roadblocks on every major road leading into the city failed to yield any clues to the whereabouts of the two fugitives. Police boats were pressed into service when a person reported seeing a man climb from the river, toss a bundle of clothes on the ground, and run to a boat. Police swarmed aboard, ready to shoot if necessary. A thorough search revealed three unlocked hatches. A neighbor said the hatches were always kept locked. Then more reports of unidentified men lurking near the docks sent 10 squad cars and scores of men to that area, all to no avail. This is the window the men used in their getaway. They cut their way to freedom with a hacksaw. All cells in the cell block are unlocked during the evening hours. The prisoners are allowed to stroll in the block. It was during that period that the four men made their escape, using the mattress covers from all of the cells. The men lowered themselves out of the window and crawled down the side of the building.
News briefs as time permits, Miami attorney Thurman Whiteside failed to show up in Washington to testify before a House committee today. Meanwhile, President Eisenhower has sent the nomination of John Cross, a State Department communications expert, to replace Richard Mack on the FCC. That's the news. I'll be back in a moment with tonight's editorial.
Say, ever hear of a boat with an outboard going 1,008 hours without stopping? Well, it happened in Miami just the other week for the boat show. The boat is a Mohawk, one of the many boats that use high-volt batteries as standard equipment. The motor is a 35-horsepower Evinrude, and the radio a Sentry RCA. And the battery, well, you tell them, little High.
Sure, Bob. I'm proud that my high-volt marine battery was chosen for this endurance run. It had to give the initial power for 1,008 hours, subjected to sun, rain, and salt spray. Proof that all boat owners can get more out of boating with my high-volt batteries. Now, these are the batteries like the one you just saw, built and labeled Marine by High-Volt, for any regular marine installation, inboard or outboard. Make sure you originally install a high-volt battery.
And you boat owners will be happy to know, too, that High-Volt is an authorized dealer for famous Silver Beauty battery chargers. Either 4, 6, or 12 ampere home charger will keep your battery in top condition. So for heavy duty, extra heavy duty, and marine batteries, remember,
you get a better battery for less
at High-Volt in Miami.
Much international intrigue connected with Cuba occurs in Miami. The latest occurrence came last Wednesday when Cuban Consul General Eduardo Hernandez was assaulted and robbed of his briefcase at Miami's airport terminal en route to boarding a plane for Cuba. Three men have been arrested in the case, released on bond. The fourth, who ran off with the briefcase, has not been caught. This afternoon, a courier delivered to me the briefcase with a letter read earlier in the program. Now, my position in this matter is not partisan to either side. Because of news interest, I showed you the disputed contents of the briefcase. Obviously, there are two sides to every war. There is a war going on in Cuba. Consul Hernandez is using his intelligence forces in Miami to obtain information on rebels here and what these rebels are up to. The rebels in Miami, on the other hand, are engaged in gathering arms, ammunition, stirring up resentment against Batista. In my opinion, the best thing for Cuba is a national election. One will occur this June, though, but opponents say the election is rigged. That Batista's hand-picked candidate has no bona fide opponent. Leading civic groups, along with the Catholic Church, have called upon Batista to resign and put in power a national union government, which would then call a free election. Batista, however, today, in his March 10th anniversary speech to Cuba, said the only solution lies in the June 1st election. One thing is certain, things will get worse, not better, in Cuba. General strikes and violence will spread. It seems to me the question is not so much who is right, but what is right. Batista and the rebels represent extreme opposites. Both factions should step aside and let a national union provisional government call a free election. It's imperative that peace return to our neighbor nation. Good night. May the good news be yours.
Watch Ralph Renick reporting every weeknight at this time. Tonight's program presented by Hybel Battery, exclusive maker and seller of the best battery you can buy. Hybel. The preceding news, weather, and sports shows directed by Bernie Rosen and Dick Renick.
Time for a break. We'll be back with more Rewind in just a minute.
Cool programs for hot jobs. Let Miami-Dade College jumpstart your career. We offer bachelor's degrees in film and TV production, nursing, electronics engineering, information systems technology, supervision and management, supply chain management, or choose from 300 other programs to study. You can take classes during the day, evening, weekend, or online. For more info, visit mdc.edu or call 305-237-8888. Get the knowledge and training for today's in-demand jobs. Register now, Miami-Dade College.
Next, a real rarity, a local entertainment program from six decades ago. In the early days of South Florida television, Lee Dickens made a name for herself as a broadcast daredevil.
This young lady believed excitement made a good program. Here's an excerpt from one of her weekly shows. She walked the wings of a high-flying airplane. She even climbed one time our 1,000-foot tower and went snake hunting. How's this for thrill?
We don't have Lee Dickens wrestling alligators or hunting snakes, but we do have this 1954 show featuring Dickens climbing to the top of WTVJ's 1,002-foot tall broadcast antenna in Hallandale. So sit back, relax, and enjoy the view.
Welcome to the Lee Dickens Show.
Above towered the highest steel structure south of Richmond, 1,002 feet to be exact. This is WTVJ's new long rifle. Power, 100,000 watts, the strongest sound signal in the country. As Jack Webb would describe it, 15 men climbed to the top for money. I did it for nothing. I'm crazy. As you know, we switched to full power Tuesday, the 18th of May. And for those of you who have been getting a picture like this, it began to come in like this. And then suddenly...
Hello. Well, it's nice to be with our old audience, and we certainly look forward to meeting the new audience. Thanks for inviting us into your home. Well, here at WTVJ for the past 10 days, we've been receiving on an average of 400 phone calls a day. Here's a sample of what goes on. Hello? Yes, sir. The transmitter is out. No, we're trying to locate the trouble. It'll probably be a week to 10 days. You've already moved your antenna to face the antenna over the tower, and now you're waiting for a good picture. We understand, sir, and although you're unhappy, please believe me, we're doubly unhappy. Try to bear with us. Thanks for calling. Bye. Yes, it seems that everybody in town has been asking just what happened. Well, when we finally located the trouble at the very top of the tower, we found out that it was a burned-out junction box. What it meant here in town, nobody seemed to know. Well, take a good look. Here's the culprit. And it's charred black. And here's the story of what happened. This is the new WTVJ tower. Higher even than the fabulous Eiffel Tower of France, and twice as high as the Washington Monument. Somewhere between the base and the tip, something had gone wrong. As I look skyward, Earl Lewis, chief engineer of WTVJ, and Bob Bauer, assistant chief engineer, talked about what had happened.
A section of the pipe had been lowered from the trouble spot, and as we examined it, Mr. Lewis said, "It's not uncommon for new antennas to have a few bugs in them, but we hit the jackpot. We had to test the whole tower, section by section, from the bottom up, until we finally found the trouble at the very top of the tower, the highest and the hardest part to get at." Here it was, one pipe, charred and burned through. Cost no more than a few dollars. Result, it put a $750,000 transmitter out of operation. Cause, one defective bit of wiring, short-circuiting in this junction box and burning it out. Mr. Lewis said, "To you it probably seems a little strange that such a tiny piece of equipment could cause all this trouble. But when you get up there, maybe you'll understand why." So, up we went. The elevator rose at the rate of 100 feet a minute, heading for the 800-foot level. And as we went up, you couldn't help but think that this giant, when it was fixed, would put a picture into Nassau to the east, Fort Myers to the west, Vero Beach to the north, and Key West to the south. Down here, a home goes up in 3 months. But this tower was a little different story. It was almost 3 years in the planning and the building. Why? It's the first tower of its height to be erected in a hurricane belt. And since it is, engineers from all over the world will be watching to see how it behaves. Even the steel in the tower was selected after exhausted tests at MIT. It's round instead of flat, to offer less resistance to hurricane winds, ranging up to almost 200 miles per hour. Instead of the base being buried deep into the ground, the tower rests on a ball bearing about a foot in diameter, so that the tower can rock with the wind instead of snapping off. If you've ever had a clothes pole that had a tendency to lean, you've got a pretty good idea how this tower has to be braced. There are 12 concrete anchors located in two circles, 300 and 700 feet from the base of the tower. And each anchor weighs 360,000 pounds. And there's enough concrete and steel in all 12 of them to build a magnificent 130-room oceanfront hotel. The elevator only goes as far as the 835-foot level. You have to climb the rest. It was hot down at the base of the tower, but up here it was cold and the wind was blowing. I wasn't too conscious of the height until I looked over the side. You could feel the tower swaying. Right now, we were higher than the Eiffel Tower. And as I looked way down at the ground, I began to really get scared. And I thought to myself, I'll take an alligator anytime, Saturdays and Sundays included. As we climbed, the steelworker and myself, I began to get a tremendous respect for the men who built this structure. Only 15 men actually climbed this tower to work on it. When the wind is blowing more than 15 miles per hour, or just after the rain, nobody goes near the tower. There's too much danger of being pitched off or slipping on the slick, wet steel. If this tower were located in New York City, this and the Empire State Building would be the two tallest buildings in town. Now you're at the final level. From here on up, the ladder is on the outside. As you climb up the outside ladder and reach for the rungs above, one at a time, at least you can see where you're going, which is straight up. But as you go, the thought occurs stronger and stronger that sooner or later, you'll have to come back down. And it isn't a pleasant thought. As you look down at it, it looks this way. Five rungs above, the ladder stopped. But above the place where the ladder stopped, GE men were working. At least I could hold on to the ladder. What they were holding on to, I didn't have the slightest idea. This is the heart of the antenna. This is the last place the picture leaves before coming into your living room. This is where the trouble was. If it were up to me to get up there and fix it, I think I'd just forget the whole thing and build another tower. When the tower went out, we got an average of 400 calls a day complaining about the new tower. But if you think you felt badly, look at it this way. How would you feel if you bought a brand new Cadillac and before you ever had a chance to drive it around the block, it broke down? Well, that's the antenna story. Thanks for inviting our picture into your home. We think we're here to stay this time. And we'd like to thank the cameramen for all their help, the ones on the bottom and the ones up above, because without it, we couldn't have gotten those pictures for you. Hope you enjoyed tonight's story. We'll see you next week at the very same time. Until then, a very, very good night to you all.
That's about it for this edition of Rewind. Just time to mention that if you noticed an occasional jump cut or an awkward edit, remember, not all of the shows that have come down to us are complete. Some are missing scenes or whole segments. But all of these shows, even incomplete ones, offer us a fascinating glimpse of Florida's history. They're well worth a look. Rewind features historic film and video from the Lynn and Lewis Wolfson II Florida Moving Image Archives. To see more from the Wolfson Archives collection, visit our website, wolfsonarchives.org. You can search the archives catalog, watch video online, and connect to our YouTube channel. There you'll find hundreds of carefully curated clips. Or link to the Wolfson Archives Facebook page to keep up with our busy calendar of historical happenings. Until next time, I'm Kevin Wynn. Thanks for watching.
Dip, 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 dip